I invite you to listen with open ears and receptive hearts to the Word of God coming from the 17th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun. His clothes became as white as the light. Just then, there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said. "Don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. Here is a little known fact. I have preached for this congregation before. It was a long time ago. It was in the fall of 1990. I was being considered for a position in one of the churches in this presbytery, and Mendon was asked if they would host the neutral pulpit. So I preached what I thought was just one of the finest stewardship sermons ever heard. I did not get the call. I'm back. I have served in many places. My first 15 years in ministry, I served congregations in Memphis, Atlanta, Indianapolis, and Chicago. And then I began serving presbyteries, first in Chicago, then back in Indianapolis, St. Louis, and now here. So I have seen the Presbyterian Church all over the place. And being raised in Philadelphia, I knew that there was one right way to be Presbyterian. And I have to tell you that no one else thinks that. The church I served in Indianapolis had a service really similar to yours. And my son, who is now 25 and a lawyer, believe it or not, I can remember him on the first day of that service, a whole row of second grade boys sitting on the front row in this very gothic church and just moving to the music. And from what I know, there are all still involved in church. And I just give thanks to God for that. And it's one of my happiest memories. Now, my job there was older adult ministry. So you can imagine what I was hearing about the service. But each time I would say to someone who was complaining that it just wasn't right, I would say, "I just want you to come and watch the row of second graders. That's all I'm asking." It's still a very powerful service today. It's a delight to be here with you. It's a delight to be here with you on this particular Sunday, which is the first Sunday after Pastor David's retirement, but also is the day on which we celebrate what we call the Transfiguration. It's the Sunday before Ash Wednesday. I was so pleased to see that you have your Lenten studies already going. I've heard very good things about the series you're beginning with N.T. Wright, and so I'll be really interested to get your feedback on that series. I've been using a particular commentary of which he has written several volumes. So last week I was in 1 Corinthians for Everyone. It's a really wonderful series. So here we are on Transfiguration Sunday. It's always the Sunday just before Ash Wednesday, just before Lent begins. You can have Transfiguration Sunday pancakes and then Lent. This story is the same each year. It immediately follows that conversation that Peter has with his, excuse me, that Jesus has with his disciples. Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answer, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And then Jesus asks, "But who do you say that I am?" Exactly. That's exactly what Peter says. He says, "You are the Christ. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus, at least in this version, commends him and says, "You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church." But Peter can't bear all the truth that Jesus is telling him when he hears that the Son of Man will suffer and die in Jerusalem. He says, "Oh Lord, this can't be true. It will never happen to you." And Jesus rebukes him. It's 6 days later that Jesus takes Peter and James and John, who are brothers, up a high mountain. And in their presence, he is transfigured, which is to say, he shines like the sun, his face, his clothing. And they are amazed. Even more amazing, he's not there by himself. He's there with Moses. They see Moses. They see Elijah. They know something unbelievable is happening right before their eyes. Peter, struck by this, wanting to save the moment, says, "Lord, let us build three shelters for you, three tents." But while Peter is asking this, a cloud overtakes them all. And from that cloud comes a voice saying, "This is my beloved. This is my son. Listen to him." They are terrified and they fall down on their faces, hugging the ground. But Jesus touches them and says, "Get up, do not be afraid." And when they look up, they see Jesus himself alone. And for all you Greek fanatics, that's really some very particular language. Matthew wants you to know that Jesus is the only Son of God. He is not Elijah. He is not Moses. He is not a prophet. He is not John the Baptist. He is the only Son of God. So Jesus is transfigured. But it's their lives that are changed. You know, he was the Son of God before the Transfiguration, and he's the Son of God after the Transfiguration. He knew what his mission was before the transfiguration, and afterward, he knows exactly what his mission is. His before and after are the same, but their lives are changed. Their lives are transformed to know that Jesus is the Son of God, and that he lived and died and was raised to save our lives is transforming. And it's not transforming for Jesus. It's transforming for us. Wow. What a story. Incredible. And I think of all the different places that I've served in which I have seen amazing transformations. There is, thank goodness, a wonderful mountaintop experience. But you know, the rest of the action takes place in the valley. Because Jesus doesn't agree to have that moment encased in bubble wrap or a tent or a tabernacle or anything else. He says to those disciples, get up. And he walks with them down into the valley. And as he does, he explains. He first asks them not to tell anyone. He said, don't tell anyone about this until the Son of Man is raised. And then they just go on doing what they've been doing. And what have they been doing? They've been traveling from place to place. And Jesus has been healing people. And that's what happens next. The next thing they encounter is the boy who is having seizures so violently that sometimes he falls into the fire and is terribly burned. And sometimes he falls into the water and is at great risk of drowning. And Jesus heals him, which is to say that life goes on. And in the churches I've served, and in this one, I believe life goes on and transformation happens. Not so much on the mountaintop as it happens in the midst of our real lives. I was thinking of the first church I served, which was in Memphis, Tennessee. I started a young adult Sunday school class. Now, young adult was loosely defined. You could pretty much decide if you were a young adult or not, but it was mostly people in their 20s and 30s, some single, some married, some with young families. But in the great tradition of the South, which I still miss, Sunday school was something you did every week, no matter how old you were. So when I got there, and as little Miss Philadelphia said, well, when do you stop Sunday school for the summer? They said, what? And they told me, they said, pastors come and pastors go, but Sunday school you can depend on. Yeah? So I started a Sunday school class, and it was a great class. There was a couple in that class, Lynn and Wally, who were just wonderful folks. Lynn had to leave the class for a while, but for a very good reason. She was teaching the early elementary age Sunday school class. And we were talking in our class about how God was at work in us and how our lives were changing. And her husband, Wally, was in that class, and he said, you know, I feel like my faith is about this deep. But I can sense that God is doing something in my life. And the class asked him to tell the story about God, what God was up to with him. Well, Lynn was pregnant with their second child. And it was a much more difficult pregnancy than her first. And so, man, getting up Sunday mornings, and she was a good Sunday school teacher, so she was always beautifully prepared. But getting all that stuff up the stairs and being with the kids when she really didn't feel good was hard on her. And so she asked Wally if he would just come into the class with her and help her carry everything up the stairs, but just to be there in case she needed to leave the room. And so Wally did that. Now in that class, there was a young guy whose name was Michael. Michael was in first grade. And Michael was a very sad and a very anxious child. He lived with his grandmother. She brought him to church. And the reason he lived with his grandmother was that his mother had taken the kids to mom's and then left the state to go live with a man who didn't want her kids. And so here was grandma, who was near retirement age, trying to raise these kids. And she was exhausted. Now, Michael was really having trouble learning to read. But everyone noticed that when he sat on Wally's lap, his reading was much more confident. And so every time it was his turn to read, he would sit on Wally's lap and read. And so Lynn and Wally began taking him to lunch after church, so his grandma would have a few hours to herself. And their son John, who was in preschool at that point, thought Michael hung the moon. Just loved him. And so lunch grew into family outings and going to the zoo and all those good things. And Michael kind of became a member of their family, too. Lynn had the baby. It was another boy. I had asked her beforehand, what were they thinking of in terms of names, and she told me that they were going to name him for her uncle, who had died as a very young man. And so his name would be passed along. And they sent out birth announcements, and they sent one to Michael. And he was so delighted. He got home from school, and he had his own mail. Can you remember that? I mean, it's, you know, we're all dinosaurs, but hey, he had his own mail. And it wasn't on the computer, it was an envelope. And he ripped into that envelope, and he pulled out the birth announcement. And he read the birth announcement out loud to his grandmother. And he said, they named him Michael. They named him after me. They really love me. Can you feel his life being transformed? Can you feel that he knows that he has loved in a way that he did not know before? This was the transformation that was taking place in that church. So I told Wally about, because the grandmother told me the story about the birth announcement, and I told Wally, I just want you to know. And so he then took the story back to his Sunday school class, and he said, you know, I've always thought my faith was pretty shallow, but God is at work in me, and my life is changing. I'm a better husband than I was. I'm a better father than I was. And he said, I'm not sure I understand it, but I feel it. And later that year, he became an elder of that church. This is where our lives are transformed. And you know, we have some mountaintop experiences. And we have those moments, and I just want you to think of one in your own life where you have had such a wonderful moment and you just want to hang on to it and build a tent around it. Wrap it in bubble wrap, whatever, so you can hang on to it. And those moments are amazing. But the change is lived into in the valley. Jesus did not let them stay up there. Jesus insisted that they come back down, and they immediately continued what? Exactly what they had been doing. But they were changed forever. It took a while to see that. In Peter's case, it took quite a long while to see that. He had some trouble. What I know about you, about your congregation, is that in the past 20 years ago, you and Pastor David have had some really amazing experiences. I think some of them could even be called mountaintop experiences. And this scripture is the challenge to allow that to change you and then to live it out, because the story is going on. And I believe that God has both more mountaintop experiences for you and also more time living in the valley as you will live into your transformed lives. The disciples fell on their faces. They hugged the ground. They were so scared. And Jesus came and touched them and said, "Get up. Don't be afraid." And as they were getting up, they looked up. And what they saw was Jesus inviting them into their future. May it always be so. Let us join in singing. Oh, I'm supposed to do a number of things here. Gotta follow my notes. As we sing, "Lord, I Want to Be a Christian," the senior highs will be dismissed for the sermon talk back. Let us stand and sing as we are able.
Thank you.
as we pray together, I invite you to lift up the names on the weekly prayer list and to take this home with you so you can keep them in prayer. Mike Flosher? I even tried to give myself phonetics and still missed it. Mike, we are so delighted you're here and that you're feeling better. And Mike is asking for prayer for recovery. No? Okay. Keep Mike in prayer. He's recovering. Thanks be to God. Deb Spillane will be having some surgery this week. And so please also keep Deb in your prayers. Let us bind our hearts and minds together. Gracious God, this is the day that you have made, and we indeed rejoice and are so glad in it. We thank you for this supper. We thank you that we can hear your word. Lord, you have so many amazing ways of nourishing and nurturing us for your service. Today especially, we want to lift up the people whose names appear on the prayer list and those whom we know in our hearts are in need of prayer. Lord, we pray for places in the world that are just so war-torn. Today especially, we lift up the Ukraine and Syria. We lift up Uganda. Lord, may your witness be carried to those places. May the peace that we know in you become the world's peace. And may we be agents of your peace. Lord, I lift up the life of this congregation in its time of transition. So many awesome things have happened here, and so many more lie ahead. Lord, as we face some grief, some anxiety, and a good deal of hope, let us be kind to each other. Let us care for each other tenderly and fulfill our commitment to serve Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Lord, in all things, we praise your name, knowing indeed that you are on the mountaintop with us, and that you never forsake us in the valley. Especially in this time of Lent coming, we pray for a time of prayer, a time of learning more about you, a time of learning more about ourselves, so that as we prepare ourselves for Good Friday and then for Easter, we may know the resurrection power and your love that will not let us go. Lord, as we give you our tithes and our offerings, we pray that you will know that these are a sign and a symbol of our commitment to serve you always through Jesus Christ. Let us pray the Lord's Prayer as we sing.
Your kingdom come, your
go in peace and live as people set free by Christ. Serve the Lord rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the love of God in Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit's encouragement and confidence be with you always. Amen.